Yes, there's lots and lots and lots of science, and some of it's very interesting to read about. But can it ever replace or explain what it is to be human and be involved in a story? Then I think not.
Welcome to Storytelling Insights, art, science, and great conversations with storytelling insights from researchers, artists, teachers, and many more.
Got it. It's me. Right over your lovely face.
thank you. Well, welcome, Simon Hall. I an acquaintance, a colleague, and soon to become a friend, I hope, because we recently met at the Swanwick Writers Summer School. Welcome, Simon.
Thank you. Yes, and friends indeed. What a great week we had in the sunshine.
Yes, yes. Simon is a communications expert. Tell us a little bit about your work, Simon, and, you know, what you do, and specifically, what you love about stories.
What do I do? Well, these days I run my own business communications agency called Creative Warehouse here in Cambridge, where I live and work. And we tell stories for many businesses that we work with. On top of that, I'm a writer. I've had 8 novels published, a series of non-fiction books on business communications. I also still write bits of journalism for a couple of newspapers and magazines. And I was a BBC News correspondent for 20 years, specialising in environment, home affairs, and business and economics, which has sort of set me off on this current path where I do a lot of business. And I spend a lot of my time teaching here in Cambridge at the University of Cambridge, teaching communication skills to some of our brilliant researchers and scientists and academics here. Because the curious thing is that they're very, 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 very clever at so many things, but sometimes they're not always great at telling their story. And I help them to do that.
Wow. Thank you. Well, a very long list of accomplishments. So where should we even start?
It's very kind of you. Start wherever you like, and I'll try and deal with it.
No, thank you. Well, welcome. So as you know, Simon, very, very much interested in storytelling. I combine mindfulness because I practice and teach mindfulness with storytelling to create something I call mindful storytelling. And I recognize that stories have a lot of potential for us as the human race to understand ourselves better, to potentially change the world for the better. It has some limitations too, which I'd like to also get to. But can you maybe share a little bit about maybe the journey of storytelling for you? Like, what really got you switched on to that? And where do you think the power in the story lies? What is it about the story?
It's a wonderful question. For me, I think stories guided my life. I was a fairly troubled child when I was at school. I grew up on the Sussex coast, and I went to a comprehensive school, which was a little bit on the rough side. And my parents were newsagents, and there was no history of university or learning or real success in my family. And I really was quite rebellious and quite angry, and I just didn't know what to do with myself. And one little story for you, since we're talking about storytelling. We were in an English class when I was 14, and we had this wonderful teacher called Mrs. Osler, Karen Osler, and she was a right old hippie. So lots of flowing, colourful clothes, beads, clanking, you know, long, graying hair. Absolutely wonderful, but with a fantastic passion for her subject. And we were in an English class one day, and I remember her setting us some homework. And the homework was to write a story about our first love. And of course, everybody was like, oh, no, homework. But even worse for us boys, homework, talk about our first love. Anyway, so sort of grumpily, sulkily, but because I really liked Mrs. Osler, I did it. And we handed the homework in. I thought nothing more about it until about 2 weeks later. And she was talking to the class about the stories about my first love. And she said, oh, there were some wonderful stories, some touching stories, some moving stories. She was like that, quite dramatic. I said, but there was one story in this class from one student who I found just wonderful, absolutely wonderful, outstanding, amazing, joyful, so original, so moving. And I'm thinking, who's this blooming creep then? And then she turned around and said, stand up, Simon Hall. I thought, oh, no. Every time I got asked to stand up, it was always something bad. And I wondered what I'd done this time. And she pointed to me and said, Simon, your story was the most beautiful, the most wonderful, the most original. I'm thinking, what have I done? And I didn't know what I'd done. And everybody else in the class had written about boys or girls, their first love. Guess what I'd written about, Calvin? Any thoughts?
Your pet.
No.
Pet poodle.
I wrote about music. Music, because I was an only child, and I was quite a lonely child, and I didn't really know who I was and what I wanted to do. So I'd sit in my room and listen to endless music. Some of it lamentable, because this was the 1980s. But nonetheless, the point was, it was music. And I was the only one to write about something original. And she said, I wrote a wonderful story, giving her a real sense of what music meant to me, alleviating my loneliness and finding meaning for myself and a way through life. Mm. And that, I think, stuck with me. And I think that started my journey into storytelling and writing, and whether it's the media or being a writer or a tutor here at the University of Cambridge.
Yeah.
It was that that started it all off, all that in just a little interlude a few minutes back when I was a young lad. And since then, it's always stayed with me. And I think it hopefully always will.
Yeah. Oh, thank you for sharing. Wow. Music, your first love. What are you still into? Is it still your passion right now?
Yeah.
Side of your work?
Yeah. Music is absolutely wonderful. You talked about mindfulness, and I strongly believe in mindfulness. And I think I've always believed in it, because I've always needed that space to sort of sit and think and reflect and just take a breath and just distance yourself from the incredibly busy modern world. But for me, mindfulness came across really powerfully in the pandemic, when it was such an alien time for us all. Mm. And being able to find some way of just freedom from this, it felt like a jail, didn't it? It was so very strange, so alien to our way of life. Mm. And through that, music helped there as well. And so everything from teenage years, from my first music, and my first music was Paul Weller and The Jam. And I actually saw, you're too young to know The Jam, Calvin, but I saw The Jam in their final concert at the Brighton Centre in December 1982. And then I went through the 80s seeing live music, whether it was Duran Duran, whether it was Spandau Ballet, whether it's the Style Council, whether it was Wham, but don't tell anyone I did go and see Wham, just because they were acknowledged to have a really good stage act. And it was. Although I think George Michael putting shuttlecocks down his trousers or his shorts and then bashing them out into the audience was a little bit off-putting at that point. I did not catch one, I assure you. But music stayed with me ever since. And then when I was at university, I became a DJ on the university radio station, probably because I love music, but also because, of course, I like the sound of my own voice, as you would have noticed. And then I went from there into radio journalism, and then from there into television journalism with the BBC as a news correspondent. But it's all stories and music. And, of course, so many stories in music. And talking about my first love, it was kind of a lift from a John Miles song from the 1970s, which, again, you won't know because you're far too young and cool. This goes, music was my first love and it will be my last. Music of the future and music of the past.
Wow. Thank you. Music of the future, music for the past. So you just mentioned, Simon, about your venture into journalism along that journey. And would you say that was when your sort of conscious recognition of the power of story really took root? Or did you know straight away after the music story that you wrote in school, did you kind of know straight away the morning after that, wow, yeah, stories, they have this amazing ability? Or when you got into journalism after that, was it when you had that wake up moment? I mean, I've seen some of your stuff. I've seen you presenting from the studio in the BBC. I've seen even you on site with some potholes down in the south. And also I've seen some people describing you as the only person who was able to really get answers from the police on crime. So you really had a knack for getting the story out to the people. When did you have that moment? Where did that happen? And what is it about the story that makes people really pay attention?
You know, that's such a good question. And I think, as with so many things in life, rather than me sitting there and thinking, oh, I understand, now my life is all going to be about storytelling, it just sort of weaved its way through the narrative of my days. And I always found comfort in it. I always found understanding it, whether it was me writing, whether it was reading great writers, whether it was listening to music and great songwriters. But I don't think I've ever fully understood the power of storytelling so much as I have now when I've come to Cambridge. Because Cambridge is just the most wonderful place in terms of the intellectual power and the entrepreneurialism, the dynamism, the spirit. And they do amazing things, but they are so rotten sometimes at communicating it. And yet stories can really, really help with that. And I puzzle some of the people I work with here because they're just astronomically brilliant, you know, and I have to sit down and go through with them in the most basic detail, which must horrify them, thinking how thick I am, try to understand what they're doing. And then I'll say, okay, I think I've got sort of roughly the science of what you're doing, or the technology, and I can see the potential impact in the world. But tell me a story. Tell me a story about why you did it, or why it came about, or what happened. And they look at you blankly. So why do I want to do that? I said, just try it. Just try it. And I'll give you one quick example. There's a couple of biotechnology scientists I'm working with at the moment. And they are brilliant entrepreneurs, and they have come up with this brilliant innovation, which will be great for medicine and humanity. But I got all that, but I wanted to get across, because we're currently raising money, you know, the business thing, you have to raise money to build and pioneer your science. I said, try and tell me a story about, you've told me how dedicated you are to this. Tell me a story about something that happened that doesn't just say you are, but shows me you are. You know, the old thing, show, not tell. Yeah. And they thought, well, there's nothing really. There's nothing. I suppose there was that thing we did during COVID. That's all right. What happened during COVID? So, well, we were in the university, Cambridge University labs. Of course, we all had to get out because of COVID. Then we weren't allowed to be so close together. And we were due some critical test results at that time just to get our next stage of funding. And if we didn't get these sorted, then we were out. We were out of business. So, right, what did you do? I said, well, do what you would do, of course. We went home to Ben, who's the CEO, who ripped out his front room, get all the sofas and stuff out into the hall, ripped up all the carpet, got some tiling down, bought some stuff from B&Q, and made a lab in his front room. In 2 days, they built a laboratory in his front room. And they got photos of this. I said, you didn't think that was worth mentioning? I said, well, it's just what anyone would do. He said, no, it's not. And what you showed there in that story, not saying that you've got entrepreneurial spirit and you will not be stopped doing this. What you did was show me that. You showed me how nothing would stop you, not even that dreadful pandemic. And that was one little story which we've used ever since when we do presentations and talking to potential customers. And every single one, that's what people remember. And that's the power of storytelling.
Wow. So this show, don't tell. And as an aspiring author myself, you hear this a lot from all the editors, don't we? You know, show, don't tell. And there's something connects with the imagination. But you also said something there about show me why. So not just show me what. So do you think, is the story a more powerful doorway into what motivates people? Is it a more powerful entry point into the real sort of reason for the fire inside of each person, inside of each of us? Would you say that that's maybe what show, don't tell means? Or is it that it just really grabs your attention from an imagination point of view? Or what's really happening there?
There's a lot of science of storytelling, because it, like you, like me, many people are fascinated by it. And there's lots and lots of research. And I won't bore you with loads of the details, partly because I don't really understand them. But in summary, what stories do is this. If you've got a fact, but okay, it's vaguely interesting, it's a fact. Yep. But stories light up our brains. They light up our minds in a way that mere facts cannot. And they stimulate the production of what's called the happy hormone, which is the love hormone, the happiness hormone. They actually make us think and feel in a way that mere facts don't. And I'll give you another example, since we're talking about storytelling. Imposter syndrome. You felt imposter syndrome, right? Yeah. Yep. Some days you feel you're not up to it, you can't do it, what the world expects of you, you're not good enough.
Yeah, I'm not capable of doing this. Who am I to deliver this thing?
Exactly. You know, exactly. Well, you try standing in front of hundreds of people at a lecture theatre at the 800-year-old University of Cambridge, ribboned with Nobel Prizes. You'll certainly feel that. I do. So sometimes you feel the imposter syndrome. I feel the imposter syndrome. Let me tell you about how to deal with the imposter syndrome. Okay. Now, I could just say to you, Calvin, don't worry about the imposter syndrome, mate. Everybody has it, right? And you'll go, oh, thanks, Si. And you probably won't remember that, will you? However, let me put it this way to you. My main charitable work is going around state schools like my own and talking to the youngsters about the possibilities of their future, trying to raise aspirations, trying to inspire them a bit, because I've got authenticity about that. You know, I came from a background very like theirs. I don't have privilege in my family, and I've done all right for myself. BBC, my own company, writing, Cambridge. So I try and inspire a few young people. And one of the things I talk about is the imposter syndrome. The imposter syndrome. And normally when I do the imposter syndrome, I tell stories about people in life who have suffered from the imposter syndrome. But I did an event at a school probably about 3 years ago, and I started talking about the imposter syndrome. And this was a really big event. There was about 150 youngsters. They were 16, 17, and 18 in this enormous hall. And there was the head teacher next to me on the stage, and the deputy head was there, and there was about a dozen teachers in there as well. It's quite a big event. And so I started talking about the imposter syndrome. And I was going to start telling a story about a couple of famous people who have suffered with the imposter syndrome, but I don't know why. Sometimes the instinct whispers and you've got to listen to it. So instead I said, right, imposter syndrome. You've all heard about it when we don't feel up to what life demands of us. Who here suffers with the imposter syndrome? Now, remember, there are about 150 youngsters in there. And of course, they're the age where they're a bit awkward and they want to be cool in front of their mates. So no one really wants to volunteer. So there was this silence. And the silence seems to go on for several seconds, but I thought I'll let it run, see what happens. And then a couple of students, brave students in the audience, put up their hands. And then a teacher put up her hand, also in the audience. And then next to me, at the front on the stage, the head teacher put up his hand. And then more students put up their hands, and then more teachers put up their hands, and I put up my hand, until within seconds, everybody, all 150 or so of us in that hall, had their hands in the air. And it was the most extraordinary moment of shared human experience, because we're all looking at each other. Wow, you suffer with the imposter syndrome. I thought you never would suffer with something like that. You're always so cool. And they said, oh, look, the head, he suffers with the imposter syndrome. And that guy, Simon from the BBC in Cambridge, he suffers. Everybody suffers with it. And that was the realization. We realized at that moment, it's just part of being human. Mm-hmm. And that was such a powerful moment. But you look at the difference. I could just say to you, Calvin, don't worry, mate, everybody gets it. Imposter syndrome is just a human thing. Or I can tell you that story. Which do you remember?
Yeah. That's powerful. So there is a kind of connective tissue in the story that lets us discover a common human experience, or the common elements of our human experience. Oh, hang on. We're so predicated to be social species, and our interdependence is the basis of our survival. And the stories are almost the connective tissue between those things. Then is that saying, hey, mate, you're not alone. You and I suffer the same. And the story is really that thing that helps us to realize that, rather than just saying in your example, don't worry, mate. I suffer imposter syndrome, get over it. So that story is almost making me and you become one.
Yeah, it brings connections between us. And you know, remember, stories were, before we had books and writing, stories are the way that people passed down knowledge and wisdom and information around the campfire at night, which is why the elders were so revered, because that would be an enormous social event, and not just social, but really, really important educationally, as everybody gathers in the tribe around the campfire to listen to the elders telling stories of the things that happened, and we learn from them. That's another thing about the power of stories.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So Simon, I mean, this is a, you know, I saw you doing your presentation at the Writer's Summer School in 2021. I've seen your amazing extensive list of work, including novels, 8 novels, which is pretty impressive too. So what would you say your secret sauce in storytelling is, like the Simon's storytelling secret sauce?
Oh, what a great question. You know, if you ever get fed up with doing what you're doing, you fancy working for the BBC or being an interviewer, you should try it, because you know how to put people on the spot. Secret sources of storytelling. First of all, you've got to have a theme or an underlying story that everybody relates to. See what we were just talking about, the imposter syndrome, something that everybody gets. It's often love, it's sometimes conflict, it can be something like the human nature of imposter syndrome. Then you have to have characters that we can believe in, we can understand. We don't have to necessarily sympathize with, but we can actually feel them and have some stake in their journeys. There's got to be characters. And in the stories I've told, of course, it's about me, so I'm the character. There's got to be some form of obstacle. There's got to be something in the way. Like when I was telling you about Mrs. Osler, the obstacle was I'm fighting against not knowing what my future is. It's a big obstacle. It's a scary one. It felt insurmountable at the time. Imposter syndrome, I'm fighting against imposter syndrome. So there's got to be something in the way. And you've got to have a goal. And the goal is the thing beyond the obstacle, and that is either finding yourself or bursting your way through imposter syndrome. So that you've got to have twists and turns in a story. You've got to have tension as well. You've got to have some investment in it. You've got to have some jeopardy. are the stakes high enough for you to actually be invested in it? And the stakes don't have to be like you get classic Hollywood thrillers where there's a giant flaming meteorite heading towards the Earth, and obviously we'll all get wiped out if it hits. The stakes can be quite small. They can be just a love thing. I'm really invested in this. Does this person actually want to be with me or not? So the stakes have got to be there as well. And settings are really powerful. There has to be some form of believable setting. You notice that when I talked about imposter syndrome, I set the scene a little bit of the hall, only a couple of sentences about the size of the place and the old hall. So that's those are the elements that go in it. But the critical one, the absolutely critical one, is to follow your feelings and write or talk about what really comes to you. There's an old saying that we don't find stories, stories find us. So what's telling you, talking to you, whispering in your ear, saying, write or talk about me, that's what you've got to write or talk about.
What I'm getting from this is, so there are a plethora of sources. There isn't one, but there is a big one, which is saying that you also have a new unique role in the expression of a story or your story. And that almost comes, does it come from the ether or does it come from inside of you? Where does that come from?
That's another great question. I think you've got to listen to the instinct thing. It's like genuinely that imposter syndrome story I told you when I was at school, and I remember it's called St. Bede School. I would normally have a standard way of doing that. But on this occasion, actually something else is going to happen here. And I listen to it. It's learning to listen to the instinct that whispers in your ear. An instinct is a remarkable thing, isn't it? Because when I bought my first house, which actually was a flat, and that was 22 years ago now, I decided I was going to buy, and I started looking. The first flat I saw, I was like, oh, this is fabulous. I love this. This is the one I want. But then I thought, like, oh, no, that can't be right, because it's the first one I've seen. So I've got to go out and see at least six more and check them. And then at the end of the day, I still thought that flat was the one I wanted. But I was almost talking myself out of it because it wasn't rational. It's like, I've got to see more. I've got to see more. It can't be the first one I see. It just doesn't work like that. And yet the instinct was powerfully saying to me, that is the one. You'll be happy there. And it was the one. And I did buy it in the end. And I'm really, really glad I did. So you've got to listen to that little voice inside you, which sometimes we splat with rationality because we've taught to be such wonderfully rational creatures, aren't we? We've got to think our way through and plan and all that. Well, that's true. I mean, that has a place. Of course it does.
Yeah.
But also what has a huge place is that little instinct, that whispering voice from the back of the mind says, you know which way to go. Just listen to me.
Mm. Yeah, I love that. You know, it really chimes with me and the mindfulness piece as well, because, you know, there, I actually wrote a poem called The Inner Narrator. And it is about that kind of that knowing that there is something beyond that rational mind that sits in your heart, if you want to call it heart or intuitive sort of space. So that will never set you or I wrong or any individual wrong if you're really tuning into that wisdom inside, I suppose. Do you see any sort of limitations for, you know, do stories have limitations for, we all want the world to be better, don't we? We want to see reduced poverty, you know, increase living standards for everybody, education. Most of us understand that at a really basic level. Do you think stories have, what are the limitations generally? I mean, whether that's from a communication point of view, whether that's from an inspiring to action point of view, do you see there being any limitations?
I think the only limitations are happily the limitations of our imagination, which are, of course, limitless. You think of the range of stories that there are out there, everything from Star Wars and a galaxy a long time ago, far, far away, to very tangible ones rooted in the world around us, contemporary news stories, if you like, talking about shortages at the pumps and massive queues of people trying to get their fuel so they can get to work and look after their families. So I think there are no limitations to stories you can tell. I'm sad to say the only limitation I find is people's willingness to listen. And sometimes people close their minds or close their ears. I think that's sad. For me, life is a great journey, a great adventure. I sometimes liken it to a fun fair. So the reason I think I've done quite a lot of stuff in life is that once I've had to go on the dodgy, right, I've done the dodgy, oh, wow, I want to go on helter-skelter. So I go running off the helter-skelter. Oh, wow, that was great fun. Now I want to go roundabout. So I go running off the roundabout. Whoa, that was good. Wow. Making the most of it, really. So actually being open to what people tell you, listening, trying new things. I think the only limitations are within us. And if we can cast those off, then we're doing much better in life.
So it's this almost like a self-imposed limitation in some ways.
Yeah, it's the I can't do it thing, isn't it? It's the imposter syndrome, which you can't do that. You'd never be able to do that. That's not you. Oh, that's way above you. It does. I know the damn voice. It whispers to me as well. I've just got better at managing it, but it's there in all of us.
Yeah. So that kind of partially answers my next question, actually, which was, I was going to ask you, you know, what do you think about the stories we tell ourselves? So I can see that the story of, you know, I can't do this, or I'm not good enough, or I'm incapable, or I don't know what I'm doing, is one of the problematic stories we tell ourselves, I guess. Do you see there being any other stories we either tell ourselves individually or as a collective, which are not really helping us, or conversely, that are really helping us?
Yeah, I think the stories we tell ourselves which aren't helping us are how great we are. And you know, you'll know all about culture wars and all that sort of thing going on at the moment. And it saddens me because everybody has a view, but actually there's so much more that unites us in life than actually divides us. So we can get into these siloed mentalities. So I think that doesn't help when we do that. I think we also have this annoying ability, I mean, dangerous ability, to convince ourselves that we're incredibly enlightened and we're incredibly brilliant. And don't get me wrong, you know, life and modern science and civilization has made incredible strides and achieved terrific things. But in 100 years' time, you know, people will look back at us as savages, frankly, saying, oh, God, they thought they knew anything now. Well, of course they don't. They were idiots. And then 100 years' time after that, people look back on them and think, oh, what a bunch of wallies they were, thinking all that stuff. It's every generation privilege to look back on the others and think, oh, we're much, much better than them. But actually, they found their own way and doing the best they could at the time. So I think a bit of humility can really, really help us. I mean, that is important. That's something I try and bear in mind. But in terms of what actually can help us forward, what's really positive for us, just a sense of what can be done. And I was having a little joke with some friends and colleagues here at the University of Cambridge. I'm very privileged to work here, and I love working here, and it's an extraordinary experience. But with 800 years of history behind it, things can move at a rather slow pace, to say the least. And during the pandemic, Cambridge surprised itself by actually getting a shift on and doing some things pretty quickly because we didn't have any choice. And now we come out of the pandemic, and everything's slowed back down again. And I was saying to some people the other day, do you think that's right? Because we've showed ourselves that we can move fast and we can be dynamic and we can be bold and we can be really imaginative and creative when we want to. Is it the right thing now just to say, okay, well, that's all over with. We can go back to being rather slovenly and complacent and self-satisfied. So I think that's a danger. So yes, there's pros and cons, but a bit of humility helps. But also on the other side, understanding what we can do. And we can do some amazing things when we do them together or we do them ourselves, when we set ourselves goals and we really go for it, and some of the results can be remarkable.
Yeah. I'm really enjoying listening to you. You've got the art of storytelling down to a science.
Well, I'm glad someone is. I might write that down and say I'm really enjoying listening to you. The nicest thing anyone ever said to me.
How would you differentiate the difference between the art and the science of storytelling? Could you, or would you even?
Yeah, you can. Do an experiment. Look up online when you have a moment, science of storytelling, and you will see there's lots and lots and lots and lots of studies and research and wise words being expounded upon it.
Yeah.
But can they ever sum up the humanity you feel? The reason you cry at the end of a certain film, the reason that I might go and watch James Bond later, by the way, you know, the reason that you know darn well you're in a spoilers on that later. No spoilers. But it's the power of the story, isn't it? You know darn well you're in a theatre, a movie theatre, and you know darn well these are actors, but still like, oh, hang on, they're coming again. Oh, he's finished. Oh, God, he got out of that. And you're part of it. It's absolutely remarkable. So, yes, there's lots and lots and lots of science, and some of it's very interesting to read about. But can it ever replace or explain what it is to be human and be involved in a story? Then I think not. There is an infinite number of ways to tell any story. One of the exercises I do with some of the businesses, the young businesses I work here in Cambridge, is we work out a way that they're going to do a 5-minute presentation for, say, investment or for customers. And they work at it, and they get it absolutely spot on. I'm really happy with it. And they do the presentation. And I say, great. Now I'm going to do it in a completely different way. And they're like, what? I said, I want you to see how you can change the story and tell it in any given way. Can you start at the end? Can you start at the beginning? Can you start somewhere in the middle? There's no way of telling a story. There's an infinite number of ways of doing it, so long as it works. And if it works, then it works.
That's amazing. Yeah, yeah. No, I really, really, really found this an insightful conversation. And I really love, you know, what you said there about, you know, you can read a million papers on, you know, the neuroscience and the chemical changes in the body, which I absolutely love the discoveries around that. But what really makes somebody cry? And what's fascinating, too, is this embodiment side as well, kind of, you know, I once read a paper some years ago about embodied cognition, and the body is in itself a big part of our rational experience and emotional experience. And a lot of the storytelling science talks about the brain, of course, what's happening, what else is happening in the body too. So I find that these two really fascinating areas of exploration. But yeah, I really appreciate your time. Is there any one thing that you could maybe leave with us to say, you know, if you want to do something with your storytelling for the future of your life, whether it's your personal individual life circumstances or your community or the world. And you said, if there's something you would be able to share with us about storytelling and how that would impact those areas, what would that be?
Yeah. Every time you've got something important to say, rather than just say it, find a story. That's the way to say it. And I'll give you a little humorous one to sign off with. I sometimes teach the art of writing blogs here in Cambridge. And I did one course, which was online about 3 months ago. And it was a really important one because it's a very select group. It was chief executives only. And there were 5 of them. And they were from some really big hitting companies. And so I knew there was pressure on, because partly the people I was doing it for were saying, please don't screw this up. This is important. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Not feeling the pressure at all. Cheers. But also because I wanted to get to know these people because they were terrific. And also there was a lot of potential to work with them again. And so I'm really happy to say we did 3 hours on how to write blogs from start to end, to narrative structure, how to set them out, everything you needed. And I came away from the course going, oh, it went well. That's brilliant. Fantastic. And so I felt really self-satisfied and smug, as people who know me will tell you is a common phenomenon, I'm afraid. So I was sitting there afterwards thinking, oh, that's great. That went really well. I'm so pleased, so proud. All the hard work was worth it. I thought I'd send the group a little note, say thank you very, very much for coming along. It was an absolute pleasure, absolutely wonderful to talk to you today about the importance, the power of blogs. So I wrote the email, sent it off. Didn't think anything else about it until one of the chief execs replied about an hour later on. He said, that was great. We all really, really enjoyed your insightful course in the importance of blogs. And I look back and the blooming email I sent them, I've got a typo, one little letter, and I talked about the power and importance of bogs and how they'd learned all about it. I was like, oh no. And thankfully they were very, very good about it and very humorous, but I felt absolutely awful. So there you see the difference. Again, I could just say to you, Calvin, watch when you type something. Typos can really change your meaning, make you look a wally, or I can tell you that story, which has the more power, which has the more memorability. That's storytelling.
Oh, before you go, I just want to say thank you for tuning in. Please subscribe to my channel. It means a lot more than you know. And I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Bye for now.